कैल्शियम इज इन द बोन कॉम्प्लेक्स विद फॉस्फोरस एंड हाइड्रोक्सीएपेटाइट. इन अवर बॉडी 99% ऑफ कैल्शियम इज फाउंड इन बोन एंड 1% इज फाउंड एज आयोनिक कैल्शियम. द प्लाज्मा कैल्शियम लेवल इज यूजुअली मेंटेन बिटवीन 8.5 टू 10.4 मिलीग्राम्स पर डेसीलीटर. दिस लेवल इज कॉन्स्टेंट इररेस्पेक्टिव ऑफ द कैल्शियम कंटेंट ऑफ द बॉडी. दैट मीन्स दैट इवन इफ द पेशेंट इज अ कैल्शियम डेफिशियंट, द प्लाज्मा कैल्शियम लेवल विल बी मेंटेन एट अ नॉर्मल लेवल. कैल्शियम पार्टिसिपेट्स इन द बोन टर्नओवर. कैल्शियम इन द प्लाज्मा इज ऑफ थ्री टाइप्स. वन इज आयोनिस्ट कैल्शियम, सेकेंड इज अ फ्री कैल्शियम, एंड द थर्ड इज द अनबाउंड कैल्शियम. इन ब्लड 50% ऑफ द प्लाज्मा कैल्शियम इज फ्री एंड इट इज मेटाबॉलिकली एक्टिव. And this free calcium is required for maintenance of nerve function, nerve permeability, muscle contraction and hormone secretion. The bound calcium is about 40% of the plasma calcium and it is bound to the protein that is albumin. These two forms of calcium are diffusible from blood to the tissues. The complex calcium forms just about 10% of plasma calcium and it is complex with anions including bicarbonate, phosphate, lactate and citrate. The calcium balance is made by the blood circulation, the parathormone, the bone and the plasma. The vitamin D will help in absorption of the vitamin D of the calcium from the intestine. Normally, parathormone and the vitamin D regulates the calcium in and out of the bone. The bone formation draws around 300 mg of calcium from the extracellular fluid and the bone releases 300 mg into the extracellular fluid. The ECF deficit is fulfilled by the absorption. The daily ECF deficit is around 300 mg and this 300 mg is absorbed from the intestine. The kidney filters around 8 to 10 grams of calcium per day. 7.85 to 9.7 gram is returned from the ECF to the kidney and around 150 to 300 mg of calcium is excreted per day through the kidney. So, as summary, the summary of calcium balance and bone ECF is the calcium is utilized and absorbed from the intestine. It goes through the circulation into the tissue. The parathormone is released from the parathyroid which helps in osteoblastic activity and calcium is redeposited into the bone by that. So, it is release of bone calcium, absorption of the calcium, formation of new bone calcium. So, this turnover range is around 200 to 400 milligrams per day. Now, the calcium absorption has two targets. One is the calcium deposition into the bone and two, it has to keep the parathormone stimulated to release the parathormone. So as we see, the calcium is absorbed from the extracellular fluid and with that calcium PTH is released, and once PTH is released, the bone calcium is absorbed and which is released back to form a release of bone calcium into the blood circulation. Now, summary of blood calcium. Bone calcium loss is transferred to the fluid and which is released to the bone calcium. So, the effect of vitamin D is increased gut absorption and renal reabsorption. So, whenever there is an absorption from the extracellular fluid, the PTH is released which increased more bone formation, more absorption, more secretion of vitamin D, and it is a cycle of bone formation as well as bone resorption. So, bone remodeling is the principal metabolic skeletal process. It has two primary functions. One, it repairs the micro damage of the skeleton. And two, it supplies calcium from the skeleton to maintain the serum calcium levels. Thus, serum calcium levels are maintained by the bone resorption. Now, bone remodeling is three phase. First phase is resorption. It occurs during which osteoclasts digest the old bones. river cell when mononuclear cell appear on the bone surface, and formation when osteoblast lay down new bones until the resorbed bone is completely replaced. So it's a full cycle of bone remodeling. The bone remodeling is the cellular mechanism behind the bone turnover. It renews the old bone piece by piece. It ensures the correction of possible micro damage, and it enables the regulation of mineral homeostasis. And it plays an important role in maintaining the calcium homeostasis. And by this method, the calcium level of the plasma will remain constant. Now, hormonal control of calcium is primarily by the PTH along with vitamin D. PTH has three main functions. It affects the bone formation, it affects the calcium excretion, and it affects the GI calcium absorption. The main purpose is to maintain the constant concentration of calcium and phosphate in the extracellular fluid. There are three principal processes. It regulates the GI calcium and phosphate absorption, renal calcium and phosphate absorption, and it mobilizes the bone calcium and phosphate. Extracellular fluid, calcium and phosphate are a major feedback of PTH secretion. A low calcium will increase the PTH secretion, and a high calcium will decrease the PTH secretion. So, the calcium regulates the PTH synthesis and secretion. An active vitamin D directly suppresses the PTH secretion. Now, if a patient has a high parathormone, then it increases the bone loss, it releases the calcium into the extracellular fluid, it reduces the bone forming cells, it reduces the type 1 collagen, and it activates the vitamin D, and it enhances the calcium absorption from the gut, and it enhances the renal reabsorption, and it conserves the calcium in the ECF. That is, it increases the calcium in the circulation. So, PTH is a hormone which increases the calcium in the circulation. Now, intestinal calcium absorption in the mammalian intestine is by two mechanisms. One is a transcellular active transport process, which is primarily in duodenum and the upper jejunum. One is a paracellular or a passive process that functions throughout the length of the intestine. So, when the calcium intake is low, the transcellular calcium account for a substantial fraction of the absorbed calcium. But when the calcium intake is high, the transcellular transport accounts for only a minor portion of the absorbed calcium. Because of the short sojourn time and because of the calcium phosphate and calcium binding protein, both rate limiting are down-regulated when the calcium intake is high. So, when the calcium intake is high, the transcellular transport is low. So, the transcellular process involves the three major steps. One is the entry across the breast border mediated by the molecular structure, intracellular diffusion, and extrusion. Now, what are the prerequisites for a transcellular calcium absorption? It is a low calcium intake. It is vitamin D dependent. So, vitamin D increases the transcellular calcium absorption. It is energy dependent, and this absorption is stimulated by parathormone. Now, paracellular process is the second most common major organism. It is around the chemical gradient through the tight and intermediate junction and then through the basolateral lesion. And this is the mechanism in which the calcium moves from the intestinal lumen to the circulation through a paracellular process, that is outside the cells. Now, movement through the calcium through the tight junction is a passive process. It depends on the concentration and electric gradients across the epithelium. It is a passive, non-saturable process. This paracellular process prevails in the jejunum and ileum. And now, this process is usually when the calcium intake is adequate or high. Now, paracellular process depends on the solubility of calcium in the distal small intestine. The length of sojourn of chyme is particular intestinal segment, and the rate of diffusion of the from the lumen into the lymph or the blood. When calcium intake is high, the paracellular wave becomes important because the sojourn time in the intestine is short and the proteins involved in transcellular routes are downregulated. Now, if you talk about the gastrointestinal absorption of calcium, as we see, around 200 milligram per day of calcium, if it is absorbed, around 30, that is 15% is from duodenum, around 20% is from jejunum, and around 65% is from the ileum. No bedside test can determine whether there is a dose of calcium salt which is safe. The parameters to adjust the efficiency of calcium supplements from different salts are renal calcium handling, endocrine excess, extracellular calcium concentration and calcium mineral deposition. Now, what are the problems with calcium supplementation? Calcium supplementation may lead to parathormone suppression. So, a judicious use of calcium and vitamin D is required to maintain the parathyroid homeostasis. Now, what is chemical elemental calcium? Each salt has a calcium ion bound to another group based on the source material. The amount of calcium used in the calcium preparation is not all calcium. In 1000 mg of a certain salt in the calcium, only a part of it is a elemental calcium which is actually active. So here we see, so these are small parts which are active. The whole of the salt, the whole 1000 mg will not be active, only a part of it will be active as an elemental calcium. So if you see about calcium citrate, it has 60 mg per 300 mg of calcium citrate. Calcium lactate is 80 mg per 600 mg. Calcium gluconate is 40 mg per 500 mg. Calcium carbonate is 400 mg per 1000 mg. And calcium carbonate is 250 mg or 500 mg depending on the salt. So the calcium containing salt have different pharmacokinetics, and these differ in dissolution, the amount which is absorbed and amount which is rendered to the bone. The chemistry of the salt and its integration would determine the absorption and the bioavailability of the calcium and delivery to its organs, including the blood and the bone. So, is all the elemental calcium absorbed? This is a very important question. So, if we see that in calcium carbonate, around 40% of it is elemental calcium, but only 10% of it is absorbed. So, that is only 40 mg out of the whole 1000 mg will be absorbed. Similarly, in coral calcium and oyster shell, this absorption is around 15 to 20%, whereas this is higher for the tricalcium phosphate, bicalcium phosphate, hydroxyapatite, and this absorption is maximum for calcium citrate, which is around 50%. So if we see about the calcium citrate, the elemental calcium is 21%, but around 50% of it will be absorbed. The same is for CCM, that is calcium citrate malleate, calcium lactate, aspartate and orotate. For calcium aspartate and calcium orotate, around 96 to 92% is absorbed because they are more organic. Now, the purpose of calcium therapy is to cause a quantitative deposition of calcium in the bone from the absorbed sources. The sufficiency of calcium absorption could be measured by bone mineral measurement and by the extent of remodeling. Now, calcium therapy can only be measured by the ability of absorbed calcium or the supplemental salt to suppress PTH and to arrest the resorption. So, in summary, we can see that the acute demands of calcium involve osteoclast-mediated resorption as well as calcium transport by osteocytes. Chronic demands for calcium results in secondary hyperparathyroidism, increase the level of PTH, increased bone remodeling and overall loss of total bone tissue. So, is the calcium supplementation effective? The studies indicate that calcium supplementation lead to bone deposition as well as bone resorption. If the bone remodeling is the driver for calcium absorption utilization, then calcium absorption will be regulated by several hormones like estrogen, androgens, vitamin D, PTH, growth hormones, TGF, PTH, interleukins, prostaglandins and TNF. So, data indicates that optimum calcium intake decreases bone loss and suppresses bone turnover. Thus, calcium supplementation should be done at lower dosage of elemental calcium at a time, and as the calcium absorption fraction decreases at the higher doses. So, you need to have a calcium which has a low elemental calcium but high absorption index. So, calcium supplements which contain carbonates are best taken with food since they require acid for its solubility. This is not the case for the calcium citrate because calcium citrate supplements can be taken at any time. Now, calcium citrate is a biological form of calcium. It is a diffusible calcium, that is, it is ionized plus complex, and it can cross the cell membranes. The protein-bound calcium will act as a local pool, and this is designed to release the immediate need to maintain the plasma calcium range in a stringent limit. A complex 10% is actually complex of iron pairs with the small polyvalent ions, including the phosphate and the citrate. The control of the ionized calcium concentration in the ECF is accomplished by adjusting the rate of calcium movements across the intestinal and the renal epithelia. Adjustments are mediated via the changes in the blood levels of hormones, PTH and vitamin D. The blood ionized calcium is directly suppresses PTH secretion by activating the PTH, and calcium indirectly affects the PTH secretion via the effects on vitamin D production. Therefore, the intestinal absorption of calcium is a PTH dependent process and not a derivative of an elemental calcium load. So, benefits of a low elemental calcium in the intestines are because a high elemental calcium may lead to a high fecal loss. A high elemental calcium will lead to a low absorption and a high fecal loss. And so, it will keep the activity of vitamin D and PTH intact. It will offer lesser calcium ions to avoid saturation of intestinal receptors. It will adjust the intestinal transit to the calcium bolus, and thus it ensures maximum absorption and minimize the fecal loss. So, if you have a low elemental calcium in the intestine, the tubular reabsorption in the urine is very efficient. That is, the 98% of the filtered calcium will be returned to the circulation. The efficiency of reabsorption is highly regulated by PTH hormones. So, increased PTH and vitamin D will increase the need of calcium, and it is by that it will increase the reabsorption, which makes the calcium absorption, calcium secretion in the urine will be less. So, if you have a low elemental calcium in the intestine, it will cause a low lithogenicity. That means the risk of renal stones will be less with a low elemental calcium. So, if there is a higher elemental doses, it leads to higher absorption and higher ECF calcium concentration, and that will lead to a suppression of PTH and vitamin D, and it promotes the calcium excretion in the urine and the excreted extra calcium, which will cause more and more formation of renal stones. So, the renal stone formation is higher with calcium carbonate. It will be less with organic calciums like calcium citrate or aspartate. So, the conditions that favor calcium absorption is gastric acid. So, large boluses of calcium carbonate are poorly absorbed because of their neutralizing effect on gastric acid. So, calcium carbonate should be given empty stomach to result in maximum calcium release. This problem is accentuated if the amount of elemental calcium is higher in the product. So, in patients with low gastric acid, like elderly patients, the patients on PPI, the patient in which secretion of gastric acid is less, it is preferable to give calcium citrate instead of calcium carbonate, because it leads to a lesser bioabsorbable and bioavailable calcium in case of calcium carbonate. Now, calcium carbonate can also cause a milk alkali syndrome. The milk alkali syndrome is due to excessive injection of calcium and absorption of antacid like milk or calcium carbonate. But calcium citrate does not cause a milk alkali syndrome. Also, the calcium carbonate will act as a phosphate binder, and it reduces the content of the phosphate, which is an important macronutrient. So, in the chronic renal disease, the calcium carbonate is often used as a phosphate binder. It reduces the bioavailability and compromises the calcium balance. So, there is a study which suggests that in terms of bioavailability, calcium citrate is far better than calcium carbonate. In a meta-analysis of 15 studies involving 184 subjects, it was concluded that calcium citrate is better absorbed than calcium carbonate by approximately 22 to 27% either on an empty stomach or an co-administered with meals. Now, there is a study on pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic comparison of calcium supplements and it says that calcium citrate is more bioavailable than calcium carbonate. Calcium citrate also decreases the markers of bone resorption significantly more than calcium carbonate in postmenopausal women. Calcium citrate also has a superior bioavailability than calcium carbonate in post-bariatric surgery patients. So in the post-bariatric surgery patients, the recommended calcium is calcium citrate. Now as far as that ICMR recommendation goes, in an adult patient, it is around 600 minimum. In pregnancy and lactation, it increases to around 1200. And in children, it is around 600 to 800 milligrams per day. Now there are different types of calcium salts. Mainly that there are two types, one is inorganic and second is organic. I'll just summarize. Inorganic salts needs stomach acid to disintegrate and reacts with stomach acid, and all calcium must be in the salt must be released with stomach as ions. It is soluble in acid, so it's not soluble in alkaline media like intestine. It is only absorbed in a transcellular absorption, that is in the duodenum and upper jejunum. And it releases calcium ions, and once into the intestine, no calcium is available because it is not absorbable in the intestine. It can form insoluble complexes, it can increase the renal stone formation, it needs vitamin D for absorption, and its loss is high in stool, and that may lead in some particular cases with constipation. It acts as an antacid and reduces acidity, and because it causes a less calcium ion release. The organic calciums like calcium citrate mediate, calcium aspartate and calcium orotate are less absorbed. Some may be released in calcium. Most of it is absorbed from the intestine. It uses both transcellular and paracellular absorption. There is very less chances of having any renal stones, less chances of milk alkali syndrome, less chances of any insoluble complexes, less chances of any constipation because of higher calcium concentration in the intestine. It can have a vitamin D independent absorption also, so it can be absorbed in absence of vitamin D as well, and the loss on the stools is minimum, and it has no chemical reaction with acid and no interference. It does not act as an antacid. So I'll just highlight the calcium citrate. It is a calcium which is a low elemental calcium salt. It has a higher bioavailability and it has organic advantages like less renal stones, less constipation, increase in vitamin D and parathormone metabolism, and the absorbability and bioavailability are better with calcium citrate. Now, calcium bioavailability is actually a factor of the chemistry of salt application. So, at all parameters, it is better absorbed. It can be taken anytime without hampering the calcium bioavailability. It is absorbed throughout the gut and it does not bind to phosphate, and thus it allows the absorption of phosphate as well. Less gastric symptoms, it improves the efficiency of absorption, it is more biological than any other calcium, and at half the dose of calcium citrate, it is more efficient. So a 500 mg of calcium citrate exerts a more bone building effect than 1000 mg of calcium citrate. It has got lesser urinary excretion, so it is less lethargic. It may actually prevent renal stones. It is treatment of choice in treatment and prevention of osteoporosis with vitamin D. There is no chances of a milk alkali syndrome. And this is a calcium of choice for elderly patients, patients on PPI, patients on ranitidine or achlorohydrate patients. Thank you.